We're back, and so too is Riley Sheahan in the Sabres organization. And we say hello to Riley as we continue here in the offseason, building towards the month of September when it all gets going once again. Hi, Riley. How are you?
Good. Thanks. Thanks for having me.
It's great to see your smiling face again. It has been a little while between, time here in Buffalo. How would you describe last season with the Seattle Kraken?
That was good. It was really cool to be part of that, the expansion team and kind of the excitement around a team for the first year in the NHL. And I mean, Seattle's a great city. We had a lot of good support there. Obviously, standings wise, we weren't in the position where we wanted to be, but crowd was sold out every night and it was a really fun crowd to play in. And we did play in a lot of competitive games. So it was good. We had a good group, good coaching staff. So I enjoyed my year there.
What was your role with the club? Now, we saw you with the Sabres a couple of years ago and you were a depth piece and killed penalties. And so you go to Seattle. Did you have the same role? Did you build on that role? What was your approach to last season with Seattle?
Yeah, it's kind of the similar role that I've been kind of playing the last couple of years. And just like you said, like a depth piece. And I was actually moved around a little more from center to wing and relied on in different areas like that. And I felt like my game started, it kind of came together a bit towards the second half of the season. And I just try to help as much as I can. And that's in the locker room, on the ice, killing penalties, doing all those little things to rub off on each guy to make sure we're playing the right way to win and trying to have some fun at the same time.
Did your pair of victories against the Buffalo Sabres cost you, Borgen, or Botterill any money?
Yeah. Unfortunately, now I've played on enough teams where I feel like I'm always writing up money and losing money when we beat the team that I played for, but it's all in good fun.
Yeah, it always seems to happen, though, that it's the same teams over and over again, right? There's guys that never pay up when there's money on the boards, and then there's guys that always get the short end of it, and you don't want to lose. You don't want to say, damn it, I don't want to pay it, but at the same time, at some point, you're like, I'm going out there, and I'm putting $200, and off of the thousands and $1,500, I'm not doing that anymore. So, that's good. It's good that at least those two wins, got the boys going in Seattle probably. Okay, so how did it all ended though? I mean, end of the season, you get your exit meeting, you go into free agency. What was on your mind when you were looking at this season and where you wanted to go?
Yeah, so I think the last 4 years or so, I've been an unrestricted free agent, or 3 years. And it's always difficult, especially in I'll just be honest, in my role and guys who play in my role where you're unsure. And I ended the year in Seattle and I felt like things went well, but you also don't know what they're looking for. And feel like maybe sometimes you're a replaceable piece with the young guy or whatever. I love my time in Buffalo. And I think I was unsure of what I was going to do. I even debated going to Europe, but I really wanted to be close to home again for if the opportunity was there, because COVID kind of put a damper in my season in Buffalo where the borders were closed and I'm from St. Catharines. So I wanted my family to be able to come and watch, and it was hard for them to do that in Seattle. So it made sense for me to sign with the Sabres if I had the opportunity. And it really meant a lot for me. Now I'll be able to have my parents come down if I get that opportunity playing. And I wanted to share that as much as I could with them.
So Riley, knowing all of that, and I think that can be terribly overlooked in at a time like this, you know, when people try to piece together how a roster comes together, but you're right. Like COVID just, it ruined a lot of experiences for people that are so close to their family and really embrace those nights when they can play in front of them. Like, did you and your agent initiate this process with Kevin Adams? How would you say that it all came to be?
Yeah, it sort of, I mean, July 1st goes by and I'm kind of used to it now, like where things aren't just happening like as you'd like them to. So I'm not overly, I don't get too impatient, I guess is the right way to put it. And we are sort of, we had a handful of teams that were sort of interested in talking, whatever, we'll keep your name in mind, that kind of thing. And then Buffalo came about. I think there was a signing where someone decided to go to Europe or whatever, and then it sort of opened up the conversation, and it really was interesting to me. And it kind of, like I said, my experience in Buffalo was so good, just with the people, and as tough as the season it was, through the standings and the coach Ralph getting fired and things like that, I really enjoyed my time. I had a lot of fun with the young guys, and Donnie was great to me, and Kevin was great to me. So just having the opportunity to come back, it kind of was an easy decision.
Yeah, I guess that's where I wanted to go with Don Granato. You know, for a year and a half now, we've been kind of seeing what the Granato effect has been with the team, with the players, different roles for different players. We saw Tage Thompson play center. I mean, if we were to ask you that when you were with the Sabres, you would have said, I don't know that that is a possibility at the NHL level. So what was it like, you playing under Don Granato and now coming back and wanting to continue learning and getting his guidance?
Yeah, Donnie's such a high character person, and I feel like their whole family sort of has those attributes. I had Tony when I was in Detroit, and then Cammy was in Seattle. So
yeah.
I just feel like he's got the ability to pull things out of his players that maybe they're sort of hiding a bit, and they just need a little bit of a little bit of guidance to bring that out. And you can see the way he's done that with a lot of his players, a lot of the young guys, even some of the older guys need it too, where you kind of get in a funk and you think you're, you just get comfortable, but you have more to give. So Donnie's got that ability. And I even like having like Matt Ellis too. I was familiar with Matt and kind of grew up in the same area as him. And I just know there's a lot of high character people in the organization, so it's exciting.
Riley, you've chosen your words carefully here too when talking about this situation, because it is a two-way contract that you're on. You were obviously willing to sign that deal. Why were you willing to sign that deal, knowing that it might not be Buffalo full-time and that it could be Rochester for a part of this year?
Yeah, it's obviously it's tough. I've played in the league for the last 10 years or so, and I didn't want to sign a two-way, but I also know that I got a lot of gas in the tank, and I think when there's that that possibility of me getting sent down, it kind of can ignite a little fire under me and kind of give me a little more energy to stay consistent and stay dialed in. So it makes it a little more challenging. But I told Kevin I'm not gonna show my attitude if I have to get sent down. It's still opportunity to be around a new group of people and try to mold some young guys into being NHL players and help them along the way. And then when I get the opportunity to play, or if I get the opportunity to play up with the Sabres, then I'm going to make sure I make the most of it and not take that for granted.
I know you're only 30 years old, so this question is way down the future, but seeing, you talked about Matt Ellis, a player that was playing a role, right, on the teams that he was with, and then turned into player development, assistant coach, staying in the game of hockey. I'm listening to you and you know, the way you approach the game, the way you talk about the game. Do you have a sense that you want to be part of hockey for a long time? I mean, some guys, you ask them if after they're done playing, if they're going to stay around, they say, no way. Like, I'm done playing. I'm out of it. But what's your sense of where, not only next year, but the next 10, 15, 20 years will keep you in hockey?
Yeah, it's been on my mind. And I like to try to think of the opportunity ahead once the career's done. And I don't know if strictly hockey, like, I would love to stay in sports. I like youth athletes and just seeing what their goals are and trying to help them achieve those things. And it doesn't have to be isolated just hockey. I think sports can just teach you so much about life, and there's some negative things about sports that I would like to help kids kind of navigate through, and the mental aspect and things like that. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't have to be just hockey, but obviously it's hard to plan out a vision while you're still playing, and that kind of takes your mind off of your goals in the game. So try to balance the two, but yeah, definitely helping youth athletics is something of interest to me.
And you've already started that without question with the podcast that you're a part of, Speak Your Mind. I think it's easy to understand why you're doing it based on everything you've just said. You're very clear in your answers. You're comfortable, maybe a tough word, but you know exactly where you are right now within the game. But you also collaborated on this project with a youngster named Tyler Smith. I'm really curious to know what you want to share about Tyler, how you came together on this podcast, and what the podcast has done for you and its audience.
Yeah, so Tyler, I started this podcast with like a sports content creating company called Torch Pro. And it kind of was just a shot in the dark. We really weren't sure what we were doing. And I was really not comfortable in doing a podcast. I feel like there's like a little bit of a, it's like a no-no in the hockey world to kind of do anything outside of hockey and just talk about yourself and things like that. And so it was a little uncomfortable for me. But as we went with it, it got more comfortable. And guys, we got some good feedback. And then we interviewed Tyler. And obviously, Tyler's got an insane story being part of that humble Broncos crash and losing 16 of his teammates slash coaches slash support staff, whoever. Mm-hmm. It just was so like crazy to me that like just how he has gone through that as such a young kid. He's only 24 years old. And my goal with the podcast was to kind of like just allow everyone to understand that each experience that they have in mental health and their struggles, it doesn't matter if you're an NHL hockey player and you have everything that you've dreamed of and you've achieved a lot of really, really cool things, or you're someone who's lost 16 of his closest people at a young age and now has to deal with that traumatic effect for the rest of his life. We just were trying to normalize that conversation. And by getting people on the podcast to open up and be vulnerable, I found that was really helpful for me when I could hear Kevin Love or DeMar DeRozan or Simone Biles or these people that were so public about it with such a big platform. I found that helpful to me. Just, it was a something we could relate to. So that's kind of the goal of the podcast. And Tyler's been great. I mean, he's such a good speaker and can kind of normalize everything after dealing with such a traumatic thing. It's so amazing. So yeah, that's kind of the lowdown about the pod.
Well, you mentioned it, like you've been in the NHL for, you know, the last 10 years and the culture in the NHL, especially, and I don't know the culture in a lot of the other sports and I'm learning about it, but it's, you know, push through, like get tough, get tougher. Like you're not tough enough. How have you been able to have that conversation with maybe not on the podcast, but just on the bus, on the plane, in the locker room with some of your teammates? Is it easy to open up with that, or do players like to close up and not share those feelings?
Yeah, it's hard because you don't want to be the guy that's like preaching about it all the time. And like, yeah, kind of like it can get a little bit of annoying when you try to like act like you're something bigger than everybody else, I guess. But I think for me, like it's made me a bit more approachable, I think, where if a guy does have something they want to talk about, and it's not just with, say they're struggling with something, it's more like how they can be healthier. And I try to be as helpful as I can, but I'm going to be the first one to say, like, I don't know everything about this area. I just try to make it a little more comfortable talking about it. So it's the conversations, like sometimes they get a little old in the dressing room where it's about certain things that maybe are a little toxic. So when you can kind of divvy those up with some conversation that's a little more meaningful, I think it can go a long way.
Riley, you've been like most players, like any athlete really, so career driven. I'm curious to know if you did do anything from an education standpoint that you were interested in earlier on in your life that you've now wanted to revisit now that you're doing this kind of stuff, talking out loud about it and thinking down the road about post-playing days and incorporating all of this, because you've already mentioned how much you would like to help a next generation when you move on from your current role.
Yeah, I definitely, when I went to school and I was at Notre Dame, I was the least bit interested in education at all. Like I was checked out. I loved the social life and I loved playing hockey. And now as I've gotten older, like it's obviously you're more interested in things that you're interested in, but like I've tried to just dive deeper into kind of how the body works and being more engaged in my training and nutrition, all those things that I know cross over into how I feel day to day. So those things I'm really interested in. And even just kind of your self-help book here and there, like leadership or like how, like emotional intelligence, all those kinds of things are definitely of interest to me. And you definitely see how it ties into the game. And if those are things you can grasp at a young age, it can definitely help you a ton.
How do players get comfortable? And maybe you have an answer, maybe you don't, but you're in the game right now. And I would never have gone to my coach or my assistant coach and said, I'm dealing with this right now. Like, you don't want to have that conversation, but do you see a change? Do you see where there's some players and some coaches that are a lot more approachable in that way to ease players into their ups and downs of seasons?
Yeah, I think so. I think it's still changing. I think some coaches maybe aren't the most approachable, but I think that's why it's important to have somebody on staff that is and trained in that area. I think like sports psychology and things like that can be really helpful. I still use like a life coach or performance coach that kind of helps me navigate through everything that I got going, from my family and my wife to the podcast to anything else that is maybe bogging me down a little, and then hockey too. So just being able to manage all those things, I think, is important, because I feel like for a lot of guys, hockey can be a good distraction where they got stuff going on. They're just going to focus in more at the rink, and hockey can be their out. But if hockey doesn't go well and things aren't going well at the rink and you're not playing well, and that it can make a pretty toxic environment and can affect other areas of your life that who knows what happens. So that's kind of what I try to get figured out. And, but I do think the game's sort of changing where people are more approachable.
I have to assume, as you talked about Don Granato earlier, that, that he falls into that category along with his staff. And we thank you for today, and we look forward to seeing you in September.
Yeah, I appreciate it, guys. Thanks a lot.